For the most part, my dear friends, educators are still discussing whether technology should be a part of school, as if it is something that teachers have some level of control over. The way we see it, the argument has already been well and truly lost. The argument we should be having is not whether technology should have a place in schools. Instead, the argument is about what place technology has in schools. In other words, in what way do we use technology? To answer this question and many more, welcoming on R+ Talks, Anna Correa, principal of the St. Stanislaus, a 155-year-old school at Bandra in Mumbai. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Behram, and thank you for inviting me to talk on two topics that are so close to my heart, education and technology. 30 years ago, when I first joined the teaching profession, the three primary teaching aids of every teacher were the textbook, the chalk, and the blackboard. In fact, I would say the textbook was like the Bible, the Quran, the Bhagavad Gita, all rolled into one. We didn't go beyond those things. But with the advent of computers, things began to change. And when the information highway, the internet reached us, there was an information explosion. And any person in the education field, any teacher who does not harness the power of technology, I think is still living in the dark ages.
So you are of the firm belief that education cannot restrict itself to textbook, chalkboard anymore?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not.
Fantastic, fantastic. Technology, as we know it, not only eases the process of learning, but it generates a significant amount of data for enabling the teacher to track the performance of students, etc. It's something which was unheard of in those days. What are your views with that?
Absolutely. You know, technology is not just in the teaching learning process. In even the ancillary departments of education, especially in an educational institution, as you said, data is a field that I feel in Indian schools we are not exploiting. Take for example my own school. It's a 156-year-old institution. Now we have students who were there in the world wars, First World War, Second World War, and we have their children, their grandchildren, their relatives coming to us for data, maybe a leaving certificate, maybe a bona fide certificate for various reasons. And my office staff has to pull down these trunks and ledgers because in those days everything was manual. Now leave that aside, in modern times we have students who are going abroad who suddenly turn up for their transcripts. Now all this data, if it is digitally stored, it would be so wonderful. And not only the storing of data, using the data and analyzing it, I mean, it would be such an asset to a school, to any educator. I think this is there is a lot of unexplored territory over here.
You could actually observe trends in education and the trends in the marking and the marks, that so much of data can be made available at the click of a finger.
Absolutely, I fully agree with you.
Yes, yes. Going back to technology, the usage of technology per se in the classroom. Now, definitely with technology becoming a part of education, lesson planning will have to introduce this aspect. So it's going to be a little bit more complex for the teacher.
Yes. You know, traditionally lesson plans were always written manually on paper. But I think teachers have to move beyond that. And can you imagine if a teacher makes a digital lesson plan? In her digital lesson plan, she introduces links. She could share that with her students. She could upload that on any platform. She could make it available to any student. I mean, imagine using technology to make your lesson so interesting. And then the teacher starts thinking in that way and plans her lesson taking all this. A geography teacher, for instance, in real time could plan her lesson using data available freely. What a wonderful experience for
wonderful
students,
experience,
right?
I think Bloom's taxonomy used to its fullest here.
Absolutely.
Yes. And talking about you, and you were saying about teachers in that era, you are a teacher who is in both the eras, the pre-technology era and the post-technology. Not post, we can say, the technology era. you've actually broken the proverbial glass ceiling. At one time, the St. Stanislaus High School had only fathers as their principals, priests as their principals. And today, well, not only somebody who is not a priest, but a woman at that, right? I mean, no offense intended, but how do you feel?
Many people ask me that question. And it's not, I don't think it's really about being a woman principal. There are great women principals out there. I've met so many of them, interacted with so many of them. In fact, women are in every field of influence and power. We have queens, we have presidents, we've got prime ministers, we've got scientists, we've got astrophysicists. So women are everywhere. What I think is significant where I'm concerned is the breaking of tradition. That 150 years of unbroken tradition of having a male priest as the head of the school. And the credit, I think, doesn't lie with me. It lies with my management, Behram. They are my management. You are a product of Jesuit education. My management is the group of priests which belong to the Society of Jesus. You know, they are educationists. So they are in sync kind of with the times. And they knew that this was a tradition that needed to be broken. And I think as educationists, we need to know when we break the traditional way of doing things, technology,
exactly,
for that matter. So I take pride in the fact that I'm part of a school that is looking forward always. And I'm part of a management that goes with the times. So that is more important than being a woman principal.
Fantastic. Yeah. Fantastic. And one of the changes that you must have noticed in all these years is that through technology, a lot of customization is possible, which at one time was very difficult. But today, you can actually foster inclusive education in its true sense, because technology is there to enhance pedagogical training.
We are talking about inclusive education all the time. If you were to check the mobiles of any Mumbaikar, including yours and mine, we would definitely have four apps: Ola, Uber, Zomato, Swiggy. Okay, now what about having educational apps on our phones?
I'm hungry.
So,
fantastic. Yes.
You know, I think we have not explored this field enough of using educational apps. And educational apps can be customized to answer the needs of our students. Not just the excellent students, but even an average student, a challenged student, a special student. Apps could be created around those students, answer the needs of students, answer the needs of teachers. If we have apps for travel and apps for food, I mean, educational apps, surely.
Different strokes for different folks.
Absolutely.
Yes, yes, yes. 156 years, you said, and you were saying that we have students who were in the world wars. Right? So in a way, you and St. Stanislaus have grown together.
Yes.
What a story.
You know, mine is a 156-year-old school. The school began in 1863. Students from all walks of life who have become politicians, scientists, singers, film stars, even ordinary folks have passed through the portals of St. Stanislaus. And so this is quite a heavy legacy for me. Okay. I'm able to do it. One thing, because of the management that I spoke to you about, they are a very supportive management. My funda is that I keep the school in sync with the times, but don't lose on what the school is all about, value that the school stands for. You know, in today's world, we need to create skilled individuals, students who think creatively, who have a spirit of inquiry. But yet, at the same time, schools like ours focus on creating men for others, students with a conscience, students who are creating a more just and humane world. So, I don't want our school, which has these values enshrined in it, to lose in this modern scenario.
So education is the all-round development.
Absolutely.
Holistic.
Sure.
Education is what you're looking at.
That is what.
That's really fantastic.
Yes.
Okay, talking about holistic education, right, and development. We have road safety classes because there are too many cars around. We have swimming classes right? And coaching, because too many kids drown. Looking at it, don't you actually feel that technology now should be a basic subject in schools across curricula everywhere?
I absolutely agree with you. Just to give you an example, last year my school did a program on cybersecurity with an NGO, and they were trying to sensitize our students, parents and teachers. And during those sessions were really an eye-opener. The amount of time our children spend on social media and the amount of exposure they have to all kinds of stuff which we are not aware of. And when I talk about social media, I don't mean Facebook and WhatsApp. They don't want to be on Facebook and WhatsApp because they know that auntie types like you and me are on Facebook and WhatsApp. They are on Snapchat, yeah. They are on Instagram, where they know their parents and their teachers can't follow. You know, they don't realize how vulnerable they are to all the cyber threats. They know things, but they are not secure in that knowledge.
Exactly.
So, you know, Behram, I agree with you that this topic, cyber security, should be introduced into the curriculum, and we should be talking about this and educating our children and our parents, because the parents also are clueless.
Exactly.
About
things
like this. Because
just as we leave digital footprints everywhere we go.
Our children don't realize that. They don't, when we spoke to them about morphing, about cyber bullying, about stalking, they are looking at us in surprise because they are just using it for pleasure, momentary
exactly,
pleasure,
exactly.
You know. So,
without realizing the deep implications
really,
and the long term.
Really, absolutely. So, this is the need of the hour, introducing this into our curriculum.
Fantastic, fantastic. With the CBSE and ICSE results showing a trend of students getting 99% and maybe even 100%, right? And you heading an absolutely... A 156-year-old state board school in the heart of Bandra. Do you think somewhere our students are losing out on admissions into junior colleges because of the trend in percentages going northwards, like going as high as 99 and 100?
You have touched a nerve with that question, Behram. I
a don't raw know, nerve, I
guess. As the principal of a state board school, I feel our students are getting a raw deal. I felt it over the years, and this year particularly, I don't know whether students and the general public who are not aware of the education system know about this, but this year particularly our state board students didn't even have the opportunity to have internal assessment in the languages and in social studies. So there were no internal marks. They had to answer a full 100 mark paper across 3 hours. My heart really went out to them, and I don't know what the results are going to be like at all. So what I'm trying to say is it's not a level playing field at all. Okay, for our SSC students, definitely. Leave aside these internal marks, which are going to cause a real dent, because the other boards have the benefit of the internal marks, whereas the SSC students don't have. I don't know why
and
it was
which we
done.
Had.
Which we had.
Which we just
this
had
is the
year.
First. This is the first year, and you know, students learn in different ways. Every student is not good at written work. There are some students who are much better at oral work and producing assignments and projects. I mean, give those students a chance. Every student cannot write a 3-hour paper.
20 marks would be a godsend for such students.
Would be a godsend. So. That was, secondly is the kind of paper that is being set for the IGCSE students, the ICSE students and the CBSE students, and the kind of exam paper being set for our SSC students. Now, the SSC paper is actually quite a beautiful paper when you go to look at it. It allows creative thinking, it allows the child to express
himself. A lot of application-based questions.
Yes, but
activity
cannot get
based.
Full marks. You yeah. cannot ever reach those high 90s. With an SSC paper, whereas with looking at the scores, see, I'm not an expert on ICSE or CBSE, so I don't know how they are scoring like that. But something seems to be wrong if students are getting 500 on 500 or 499 out of 500. It's educationists need to look at this, and my heart goes out to those students who are not scoring those 90s. There must be a whole bulk of them who are scoring in the 80s and the 70s, and you are telling them by publicizing 99 and 100% that you are not okay. we will only laud these kind of students, and you're telling my poor SSC students, you're not going to be, you're not okay at all.
I'm really worried
about admission time. What is going to happen to them at admission time? All the seats are going to be taken by the ICSE and CBSE students. I hope the state government is listening to me.
Oh my God.
And that this talk will reach them, and that they will take some corrective action. Leave aside all the other implications of the 90%. I'm talking for my state board students. I think they need to do something for them, Behra.
So here you've heard it, friends. Anna Correa has the last word on that. Thank you very much for being there with us. Thank you guys for being with us. God bless you all.
Thank you.